Shalom Rastafari. Once again, we're in a very important and special season, the Rosh Hashanah season, and we say Alta L'chaim Tovim U'Le'Shalom. May you immediately be inscribed and sealed for a good year, and Shana Tova, Shana Tova, which is to say, Happy New Year, or really good year, literally good year. Bamarinya, we would say in the Amharic, Melkam Ibrawi Adis Ameta Darasachu. May you have a beautifully good Hebrew or lunar New Year. Now, with that being said, we want to touch on a couple of subject matters that Jah has placed on our, in our heart to communicate and seek to be as faithful as possible, at least to bring these messages to you. And there's a couple of messages that we would like to bring. And at this present time, we want to bring a message on the subject matter of paying bills. Now, this is a subject matter I'm sure that touches everyone. Everyone, whether they pay all the bills or some of the bills, they know about paying bills and they take paying bills. And this is connected with, let's get this right here. This is connected with money very seriously. And this is a subject matter that often many of us as Rastafari or as Rastafari and as Hebrews, and conscious folks, it's interesting how we deal with this. We may know that money as debt, there's a couple of programs that are out there that really breaks down the history of money and the economic system and the banking system and out of slavery and maritime law. And all these are important subject matters to connect. But we want to approach this from a historical and a scriptural context and a biblical and an Ethiopic perspective. So let us begin right away with this particular subject matter. It's going to be called Paying Bills and the Babylonian Bell. Let's put this up here. Paying Bills and Babylonian, or Babylon, let's for short, for the space we have here, the Babylon Bell. Now, let us break this down. Let's underline bills and bell. Let's take bill right here, right? Let's take the word bill, and we did something very interesting. As you know, we like to put it into the linguistic and the etymological context, and it's very important for us to put these things into the etymological context. Now, this is more than just semantics. Many will say, oh, this is just semantics, and he'll say, oh, well, you're speaking about religious or theological ideas, but we need to deal with real things, you know, as though this is not real. It's very real, and hopefully this lecture will make this connective link between paying bills and the Babylonian bell. Paying bills and the Babylonian bell. First of all, let us touch on the etymology. Now, etymology means, to break down the word etymology, it comes from etymos, which means true, and logos. So etymology means true logos, or true word, or true logic, which is the root of the word, where the word comes from, what is its origin, and this is what puts it into an historical context. We need to put matters into their proper context, because outside of the proper contextualization, all we have is nonsense or confusion, or, in a word, Babylon. Babylon means confusion. Babylon means chaos. Chaos. Now, scripturally speaking, from a scriptural perspective, we know that Babylon refers to the anti-God, the anti-Christ, the anti-life, death, that which is opposite or the antithesis to that which is righteous, so therefore unrighteousness. And as we mentioned even just yesterday, I think there was a lightning strike or something that had caused the local LIRR and Amtrak to be delayed, and people were stuck on the train, so forth and so on. And one of the particular branches of this railway system goes out to a place that's known in New York as Babylon. And we made a comment that it's interesting that they would actually have a place named Babylon in a so-called Christian country. It tells you something. And we confront these sort of things, and then we just shrug our shoulder as though it doesn't really matter. And there's many that will opine and talk about other issues that doesn't really affect them, but they will talk about other issues. For example, we as Rastafari and the herb issue, the marijuana issue, or the smoking issue. You know, this has become a big issue, and people who don't do it themselves will say that we should not do it even from a sacramental basis, even as a sacrament. And there's the issue of medical marijuana, so forth and so on, and many are finding benefits in it. But we must remember that even this issue, the so-called medical marijuana, comes out of Rastafari, comes out of the Rastafari movement, who brought this front and center. But when you look at all the various programs and shows and videos and documentary, Rastafari or Rastafari is given very little or no credit or no even mention within these particular programs. So therefore, it must be up to us to bring our truth to life and to light and keep it front and center and to keep it relevant. This is a spiritual warfare. This is a real warfare. This is real life. And unless we speak our truth, then we can't expect others. Like, we watch a program and we say, well, how come they didn't mention Ethiopia? How come they mentioned black people? How come they didn't mention Rastafari? Well, how come we don't? When we see that program and it has made a critical error in ignoring half of the story that is true. This should be an opportunity, our opportunity. But see, we need to make our wills. We need to get the matter of our hearts and minds right. This is why the repentance, this is why the message of salvation, the good news of His Imperial Majesty and His Christ is front and center, and it's main and it's important. This is why this season that we know as Rosh Hashanah, as the Festival of Trumpets, and these 10 days of Or to Yom Kippur, and then 5 days after that we have In Gathering. This is why we need to understand the importance of our holy days and our holidays. Now, some would say, well, how does this all connect with paying bills? You understand? Paying bills. People say, well, we got to do it. We have to do it. What can we do about it? But what is the origin of this? Is this God's way? Is this what the Almighty has ordained, or is this a man-made construct? So we are living in a matrix, some would say, or a system of things that has been imposed on us, and we accept it as though they are a part of life, as though this is life. People say, well, you know, you got to pay bills. That's life, so forth and so on. Well, in a limited sense, yes, that's true. In a limited sense, in the reality that we're living in, yes, that's true. But there's more to it. There's a half of the story. And we have faith and acknowledge that you shall know the truth, we shall know the truth, and the truth is what sets us free. And the reason why people can't free themselves from this assumed or make-believe or made-to-believe reality is that they don't know the truth. And the truth does not get out there, and the truth is suppressed. And people make it seem like, well, that's not a relevant issue. It was about reality and got to deal with surviving and so forth and so on in this artificial man-made construct. Now, paying bills. Let's deal with Bill. Let's deal with Bill first and foremost. All right? Let us find out who and what Bill is. Now, some of you all may know that study, when we do our studies based on the Webster's New World College Dictionary. This is the New World College Dictionary. The reason why we choose this particular dictionary, unlike other dictionaries, is that as you look into Oxford Dictionary, it has what's known as the etymological brackets before it gets to the connotative meanings of the various words and entries. Like the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is the connotative. This is how it has been noted in a together sense or a common sense. In other words, there are words that mean something different in this origin, but it's taken today as it's taken today in a connotative sense or in a pseudo sense. That's not really the true sense of it. You understand? But it's a connotative sense. Now, let us get to Bill. Let's find Bill right here. So we find Bill on page 138. And I don't know if you have this, but there's a wealth of online tools and resources where one can actually look up, and some very good etymological sites and sites that deal with etymology, and even has more data than this. But this, as a dictionary, is a very good household item in every household and family and individual and disciple and student, and those of you who are subscribers should have a Webster's New World College dictionary, because in the Society of His Majesty, these are studies. This is college level. This is education. Education, as the King of Kings, Kadamawi Haile Selassie, teaches, and as he also practiced and preached, but he manifests this. Education is the key. Now, everyone would not take education properly. This is a choice. So individuals have a choice. But for those who will use the education effectively and positively, education is a fundamental, a foundation, and it's invaluable for us. So let's use this word Bill. So we find Bill here, right? There's a 1 and 2 and a 3. Now the 1 is a very long entry. Let's show you right here. So you see the 1 and then 2 and then 3, right? Okay? Now, let's deal with the first one first. Open etymological brackets, M-E, which is Middle English. It says Bille or Bill with B-I-L-L-E. Right, this is the old way, and it's derived from Anglo, and then it has L, Anglo hyphen L, Anglo Latin, Billa, Billa, B-I-L-L-A. Then it says altered. It says altered. Then it's derived from M-L or Middle Latin, Bula, 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 B-U-L-L-A, and it says a sealed document. Right. Then it goes further. We're just in the etymological brackets. It's derived from L, again, so that's Latin, and it says knob, it says bubble, and then it's a colon, and it says sea boil. Now, this is the very first entry that we have here. So we're going to look up boil. It says sea boil 1. Because there's more than one boil, right? So they're telling us that Bill is derived from boil. Now, we know that the name Bill is a short, adjective, nickname, so to speak, or another way to say William. So Bill, as a name, is related to William, which in the German is Valheim, right? Now, we're going to touch on that as well, but take some notes of what we're saying here. So even if we're not able to get to it, you'll be able to get to it in your independent studies and taking personal responsibility for your education, for the education of your family and loved ones. Now, boil one, open etymological brackets, M-E. Boilen, B-O-I-L-E-N, derived from Old French, boyer, B-O-I-L-L-I-R. Then it's derived from Latin, bullere, B-U-L-L-I-R-E. Then it's derived from bulla. Remember bulla from Bill, etymological brackets. Then it says a bubble, a bubble, a knob, a bubble, a knob. Then it says probably derived from i.e. Indo-European bu, variation of echoic bass, bui, bui, bu, b-e-u, b-h-e-u. Then it says to blow up, comma, cause to swell, cause to swell. Now, close etymological bracket, then just, let's just go over, fly over the connotative meanings. It says, one, to bubble up and vaporize over direct heat. Two, to reach the vaporizing stage. Three, to seethe or churn like a boiling liquid. Four, to be agitated as with rage. Five, to cook in boiling water or other liquid. And it basically goes so forth. Now, there is the second boil is interesting. Though they didn't direct us there, it comes right after, and we will go there and check it out. And it says, boil, originally and still dialectically, bile, B-I-L-E, Middle English, beal, B-Y-L-E, Old English, beal, same, then beal without the E, akin to the German, boule, boule, B-E-U-L-E. See how interesting this gets? Then it says, derived from, i.e., in the European base of, based of P-R-E-C, I gotta look that up, anyway, closed etymological bracket, it says an inflamed, painful, pus-filled swelling on the skin caused by localized infection, or it says a furuncle, okay? Now, that is just the etymology now of bile. Now, when we look at boil again, going back to the first one, it has synonyms, some synonyms, right, which are like words to boil, or words that can be used instead of that, like for writers and stuff like that, not to repeat the same word. It says boil, the basic word refers to vaporization of a liquid over direct heat, or metaphorically to great agitation. To what? Great agitation. Right, great agitation as of rage, it made my blood boil. You've heard that expression before. And also seethe suggests violent boiling with much bubbling and foaming, or in an extended sense, excitement. In extended sense, excitement. Now, this is all going to be very important to really understand what we mean about paying bills and the Babylon or Babylonian bell, or really false gods. We're speaking about false gods. This could come under false gods. And believe it or not, this here is one of the most powerful in the world today forms of magic and sorcery. This is sorcery. Now, people say, well, a lot of good things can be done. Yeah, because people believe in this as a currency or a means. This in itself has really no value, or in the world, it has a fluctuating value depending on men and people and markets and depending on everyone other than the majority of y'all who will be watching this, or the majority of you and me and I and I. So those who set the values to this, and whether this is strong or this is weak, it doesn't have anything to do with those of y'all who believe in this, as it says, in God we trust. Notice, the in God we trust is not on their churches. If you go in most churches, you look around, you might not in most churches find anything that says in God we trust. You'll find this phrase, in God we trust. Notice where you'll find it. You'll find this in God we trust, either in courthouses or on this dollar bill. And the two of them, the courthouses, you understand, and this dollar bill goes together. And there's a movie, video documentary, Cymatica, as well as a couple other documentaries like Money as Debt.
and we will refer ones to those programs if they have not seen it, which goes into really a detailed, some great detail. So we're not going to regurgitate all of that, but it's important for us to make this note right here. Let's make this note of this right here. Bill, right? And then let's put right here, in God, right, we trust. That's what you call a mantra, right? That's what you call a mantra right there. A mantra, like a phrase, like Hitler and them said that if you repeat a lie often enough, then people would accept it as true, which is a kind of a manipulation and a mind control. So when you look at this, though you may not look at it in detail all the time, but I'm sure at one time people have looked at this, who use it regularly, and they see in God we trust. And then they use this and see everyone else is under the same illusion or delusion. And therefore, because everyone's under the same delusion, one accepts this delusion or illusion as the reality that goes beyond culture, that goes beyond history, that goes beyond family. I mean, this right here, they said, what, love of this? And there's more love of this than there is for family, for God, for country, for, you know, we can go on with that, et cetera, ellipsis, dot, 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 dot. But now when we look at the word boil in connection with Bill, because also connected with Bill, and we had did this in our notes, because we have much to bring and share with you, but we're going to try to do this in as basic a way, touching on some of the main things so that those who will follow up and study on their own, you understand, and take personal responsibility for the education will basically be able to understand it even better through some of the basic references. We won't put next to Bill, we want to put Baal, right? We want to put Baal, right? We want to put next to Bill, Bull, right? And then an English phrase that the English people know it, but some of us have heard it over here too. Next to Bull, we'll put Bullocks. Some say Bullocks. I don't know if they Bullocks. It might be Bullocks with a B-U-L. We just put B-O-L, but really probably it's B-U-L. We'll just take a guesstimate on that right now, right? All of these are related. Even if you look at the fact that Bill is a nickname or a short name for William, right? And then we have this singer today, right? This singer today, William, he calls himself, he says, Will, right? He says, Will I am, right? This is how he breaks it down. Now, some people say, well, he's just doing that as a singer. No, this is a part of word science. There is a science to words. There's a science to language. If you don't want to believe us, then do a little study on William Shakespeare, the Shakespearean style of speech, and do a little bit of study on language. Politicians use certain language. Law and legal people use certain language. People in certain professions or disciplines use certain language. See, and the language is very important. Though they all may speak English, but they use certain styles of English in certain specific ways. You understand? And even within sorcery, and all this has to do with sorcery. It has to do with a high level of magic, and this is the talisman. This is the talisman right here. This is the talisman. This is why we say that even though people say we're about to go into digital society and this will be no more, that is a part of the psychobabble. That's a part of the psychobabble right there. They're putting out the idea. The Illuminati, the Satanists, and the rest of them, we refuse to call them Luciferians because Satan is falsely called Lucifer. He is not about any illumination. He's about darkness. He's about taking away the light, taking away illumination. Though they call themselves quote unquote Illuminati, but we'll deal with that as we get to it. So this right here is the most powerful talisman. They're telling people that, oh, this is about to be a thing of the past. The majority of people who brought forward this idea, believe it or not, are part of the system, or they are unwilling, willy-nilly accomplices. They picked up on it like a lot of us picked up on it. Oh, man, they're about to do away with the dollar bill, and the dollar bill is not going to be no more, so forth and so on. Never that. You know why never that? Because it's hard for them to match this sorcery. They cannot match this particular sorcery. This sorcery is so effective. Notice, they've changed every dollar bill, right? But they haven't changed the $1 bill. Think about it for a moment. Why don't they change the $1 bill? How come they have never changed the $1 bill? Because the $1, if you know anything about so-called magic, and it's not to get into magic and sorcery, occult, and people get all twisted about it in ignorance. The majority of them get twisted because they're ignorant of it. You understand? They've been deceived by their Nicolaitani priestical class of preachers and pastors and others that keep them in a religious spookism. You see what I'm saying? But the knowledge of it, you see, the knowledge of it, see, is different. See, one needs to have the knowledge. Knowledge is very important. Something I was reading about, it was in some of the Jewish information and resources, and they were saying that it was not forbidden to have the knowledge of certain things, but it was forbidden to practice. See, the two things was different. When it says, do not get to know any of the ways of the heathen, remember the word know is also used in the sense of sexual intimacy from the very beginning, and Adam knew his wife. But in a Western dyslexic, angle-less sense, they believe that, well, it says don't have any knowledge of what the heathen do. You understand? Nor get any knowledge of it. The word knowledge is also used in an intimacy sense in a whole different way, and unfortunately we don't have time right here to break that down. But the information is out there, and there's others that have touched on various subject matters and subsets even a little bit better and in more detail than we're able to do in this brief. Could want to keep this to paying bills and the Babylonian bell. In other words, what is the connection between the bills, you understand, or bill, in the sense of paying bills and bell? One thing we're finding that's very interesting is when we look at the etymology, to get the etymos logos, or the true word, the true logic, in the beginning was the logos. In the beginning was the word. You understand? And the word, from the beginning, was true. So now we're living in a time where it's almost like Babylon. You remember Babylon and the Tower of Babel when the Lord came down and he confused their what? He confused their languages. This is according to the Bible. He confused their languages so they could not understand one another. So there was a confusion of language. But it wasn't just a confusion of language. It was a confusion of meanings. It was a confusion of meanings. So therefore, ones could not understand one another properly. And this is what created the tribes and tribalism and cliques and cults and all the stuff that we're even dealing with still today. But when we look at the word boil in connection with bill, since the root of bill, according to the English, they say is boil. And when we look up boil and we get to the extended meaning besides the basic literal sense, and we now extend the meaning, it means to be agitated with rage. Doesn't paying bills cause ones, or if they are late or cannot pay their bills, or they want to blame somebody for not being able to worship their Babylonian bell and to worship their false god, don't they get in an anger and a rage, just like the idol worshippers, just like the false god worshippers that we read about in the Bible? Now, the next word here, it goes on to say, the basic word refers to vaporization of a liquid over direct heat. The vaporization of a liquid over direct heat. We can also connect that with much of the idolatry worships that also use fire and water and boiling and sacrifice and so forth and so on. Now, it says, metaphorically, to great agitation, as with rage. It made my blood boil. It made my blood bill. It made my blood bell. Will I am, William, is related to the name Bill. Now, some of you have probably heard about Alistair Crowley. You understand? And he was one of the modern father of this occultism and sorcery in this present time. And he created this doctrine, this mumbo jumbo that's effective for those who believe in it, called the Law of Thelema. Now, Thelema is another Greek word. Thelema means, in the Greek, it means will. Thelema means will. So he created this doctrine, or upgraded this doctrine, called the Law of Thelema. Do what thou wilt shall be all of the law. Do what thou wilt shall be all of the law. Now, there was laws before this. What do they mean that do what thou wilt shall be all of the law? Do what thou wilt shall be all of the law. They're talking about the law for this system of things, unfortunately, this system of things that, just like prophesied, would deceive the whole world. Remember, it says that Satan is that old serpent that deceived the whole world. Did it say that, well, he just deceived the people who were over there in America, or he just deceived those people over there in Europe, or he just deceived those people over there in Africa, or he deceived just the people there in Asia? No, he deceived the whole world. You understand? This is very important. So that means that this deception, whatever this deception is in reality, it would encompass the entire world and almost the majority or all of the human beings on the face of the earth would be affected or adversely affected, not just affected. The effect would have an adverse effect, you understand, of everybody, you understand, more or less. So none of us really, in a sense, can really escape from this paying bills and the Babylonian bell. But being ignorant, not even knowing what's going on, doing these things ignorantly, you know what I'm saying? And then, as it says right here, getting in a what? In a rage, being agitated. Notice it says being agitated as for rage. In fact, this whenever I want to deal with BS, I go watch CBS. And now on CBS, they're having a local news over here, the system lords. That's what they call it, the system lords in the Stargate. And look forward to our Black Stargate series. It's still in the editing process, but our Black Stargate series. So you have what they call the system, right? The system lords, right? But then they call them what? The local, right? That means if you have local system lords, right, and they're talking about different star sun systems. But now, let's just look at it on the earth for a moment, where we're at, on this rock right here. So we have our local system lords. Now, the word lords is also can be known as Bel, or the plural of Baal, Baal, right, which would be Balaam. You understand? Balaam, or some say Balaam, you understand? Balaam. Now, let's go to our scripture for a brief un momento. One moment. Ande. Kudasai. Yeah, let's get to Revelation. We're gonna go to Revelation because we need a revelation. We need the truth to be revealed to us. So, we have in Revelation. and the Scofield Study Bible, though it's not exhaustive, still it gives some very important references here. We had left off in our Rosh Hashanah study on the 10 days of awe, the Yamim Norayim. We left off with the second church. We didn't deal with the third church. But let's deal with the third church today. So perhaps in these days, these 10 days of awe, we might be able to go through actually all of the seven churches. So if you want to get any background on the seven churches, it's important to understand the context of the seven churches. Please look at our previous Rosh Hashanah series, and I'm not too sure if it's been posted as of yet or it's in the process of being uploaded, where we speak about the 10 days of awe, or Jah Rastafari and Rosh Hashanah, 10 days of awe, the Yamim Noraim. It should be under Trumpet of Jah. It should be under that should be like the fourth and the fifth part of that particular series, the Trumpet of Jah, as well as the early church age, where it touches on the early church age, and Revelation chapter 2, where we're going to touch on right now, Revelation chapter 2 as well, to understand the Balaam. I don't know if you can see this from over there, but moving out like this so you can see this. Balaam. What's up with Balaam? Who is Balaam? Well, Balaam is lords. Lords. The lords, or the system lords, or the local system lords, or for purposes of our study, let's get something to hold this page right here so we can close this and come back to it. For the purpose of our study right here, the local system lords, all right, the local system lords, we also have what's known as the global system lords. And this now brings it to the, and look at this word for a moment, global. Let's write it bigger right here. Global. Do you see anything right there? Global. The G-lo-bal. Right? The G-lo-bal. Now some say, oh, this is all semantics. Well, semantics are very important. Blessed be the Lord God of Shem. Blessed be the Lord God of Sem. Blessed be the Lord God of the name. What's in the name? G-lo-bal. The G, and you know this G is a symbol that's used in their so-called Masonic lodges. They say the G is for God. Others say, no, the G is for geometry. Then you have the low right here, which also looks like 10. If you look at low, or the L and the O, also looks like 10. So the G10 bar, the G10, isn't this interesting? Revelation talks about this number 10, too, in a context related to it. But now the plural sense is Balaam. Here, let's get to Revelation while we're here. Now we're at the third, the message to Pergamos. Now Pergamos, oh, this is a very, another very important and an interesting subject matter, because there is such a thing known as Satan's seat. And we have to, you know, they say give the devil his due, or give credit where credit is due. The 700 Club, Pat Robinson's, they're celebrating their 50th anniversary. Can you imagine 50 years? Well, they work together. They support. You understand? People give their tithes and donations to that work because they hear what they put out and people believe in it. Unfortunately, our people don't. This is why the Bible says, unless your righteousness exceed that of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the Pharisees and the scribes, you shall in no wise enter the kingdom of heaven, which is on another but a related point. We could put this all under economy, economics, so forth and so on, because this touches on many different aspects. Remember, this is interactive. There's a technology known as interactive, which uses many different tools and resources to basically serve the people's needs. So the people's needs is not in just one particular field or subject. And often we have to touch on different subject matters. And this is where studying to show ourselves approved and studying scripture and studying mainly Torah is now we understand the so-called secret of the Jews who say they are Jews, or we understand the secret of those Jews, you know what I'm saying, which comes out of really our root, that our stolen legacy, so forth and so on. But now here, the third church is the message to Pergamos. So 700 Club is a very interesting, important program on Pergamos, and this is real. We just want to say this is real. We'll try to fill in the details if you're unfamiliar with it. But let's go here. It says, a church under imperial favor. Now, as we mentioned, we do have to review for those who might not have heard the earlier program or might not have heard our earlier lecture or documentary on this particular subject matter and might not be familiar with this, that the seven churches mentioned in Revelation are actually the seven different ages of the messianic movement, or the word of our black Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as it will go through the world in seven different dispensations. So each particular church that's mentioned, Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and the final one, Laodicea, represents this 200 or so years. So there's 2,000 years from the so-called time of Christ, 2,000 years ago, until this roughly present time, give or take, you understand, some period of time. Others thought that it would just end at 2,000, but that's not what the word really says. You understand, still, even if it ends at 2,500, it could still be in due time, not saying that it will be that far away. But we're just making a point right there. So we touched on the message to Ephesus. We touched on the message to Smyrna. Now we're going to touch on the message to Pergamos, because it's connected with this system lord, the local system lords known as Baalim or Balaam, Belaam, the Belaam. Now, Bel is singular. Bel is singular. You could say Bel was the father of the Balaam. Or Bel was the one who said it, is a singular one. Now, when you look up this, we're going to touch on the meaning of Bel as well, too, because we have in the Semitic languages Baal, Baal. Now, Baal basically means a husbandman. I mean, even Christ, in that sense, is called the husbandman of the church. So he is known as the Baal of the church. So it's not the word that is wrong, or it's not the word that is bad or the boogeyman, but it's the context and the perspective that this word is being used or abused or misused in. So we have to make this clear, because some people are idolatrous in their unregenerated mentalities. So if you say, oh, this is Bel and Baal is the one such and such, and then they hear that, like, oh, in the Arab or Israeli or Ethiopian or the East countries, they use the word Baal too. You'd be like, oh, you worship the, you know, because you're not stable. You have to understand the context. This is why we overly emphasize context, context, context. It must, because once you have the context, you don't really have to make anything up. It almost comes together, in a sense, harmoniously and so-called naturally, when you get the proper context and you approach it from the proper perspective, you know? So, the local system lords. Now, here, this is the church which is under imperial favor, and it was settled in the world around A.D. 316. Now, this is roughly around the time of the martyrdom of Kedus Georgis, of St. George, our patron saint, or our patron Kedus. In other words, St. George, who slew the dragon, is the patron saint of Ethiopia, right? And is the patron saint of England. Now, the people say, well, how is the patron saint of England? Because in ancient times, there was the black nobility, there were black people who ruled England. You understand? And England was populated by black people. The black rulers were known as the Black Britons, as the black nobility. And these black Britons or black nobility were portions or remnant of the Beta Israel. They were remnants and survivors of the dispersion, the global dispersion of the 12 tribes of Israel, the real Israel. And because of that, they also honored Kadus Georgis as their Ethiopian Hebrew brothers and sisters. So that's the link with the patron saint, Kadus Georgis, or Saint George, being the patron saint of Ethiopia, as well as being the patron saint of England or Great Britannia. That's just a little bit of background there, because I know some folks have, they really didn't understand how could this be. You know what I'm saying? And Saint George, he was a brother. I mean, we know, we see the pictures, the way they paint the pictures and so forth and so on. But anybody can paint the picture. Do you have any talent? Why don't you paint a picture that is more historically and culturally correct? We actually need our brothers and sisters to utilize their skills in this society. But the first thing we need to do is to clear the foundation. You understand? Get to the bedrock. You understand? And then begin to build on the rock, and not like others, just build anywhere, build on any kind of shifty sand. So, this 316, it says to the end, this is the subscription of Scofield Study Bible, but verse 12 it says, "And to the angel of the church in Pergamos write, these things saith he which hath the sharp sword with two edges." Verse 13, "I know thy works and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is." Satan has a seat. And in fact, if you look at those old Hitler and Nazi videos, and when they're meeting in some kind of big kind of a stadium-like, that whole design of the place where Hitler spoke during this kind of Kristallnacht, you know, light festival, they had their own heathen, devilish, demonic festival of lights, which is a satanistic inversion or perversion of God's holy Hebrew way. In other words, you'll find that the Satanists basically just flip around what God has put the right way forward. So they would have this kind of spin off of biblical principles. In fact, Hitler was an antichrist. But the way he was promoted, if you could interpret the German, and I've seen some videos where some of the older videos used to have the interpretation of what Hitler was actually saying. And Hitler used a lot of religious, Catholic language, linguistic, in what he was saying. And we think, oh, he just killed the Jews and the gas chambers. But if you could hear him speak, he was speaking like a preacher, in a sense. I mean, it was weird, but an antichrist, an ungodly preacher, you know, who was a satanic preacher, let's say it like that. Now, where he spoke was called, how can you call it, not the statue, but this this podium. In other words, it's actually Satan's seat, and it came from a place called Pergamos. Pergamos or Pergamon is in the news again. Pergamos or Pergamon is in the news again. We're going to have to do some backtrack on this and bring some of the programs and everything on that. But what we're trying to say is that what is being mentioned here in the Bible, many people thought, oh, this is just, you know, this is just Christian make-believe. It's not make-believe. You understand? It's not make-believe. What's make-believe is this false reality. You know, is the false god. This false god right here in which you trust, this false god which you love. You know, we've seen some of the Asians and the Chinese and the Japanese and some of them. They have something that's interesting where they actually burn money. They actually burn the money, you understand, as a so-called sacrifice to their gods. And when you think about it, in a sense, some of you are probably are upset to even hear that. How can you burn money? I will use money, you know, because y'all are defective. Y'all are defective. But think about it for a moment. Why shouldn't we? In fact, that's probably the best way to so-called give a sacrifice in this present construct to a true God or a higher God than this God of this satanic, what is it, sealed document? Do you remember what it said about a bill is a what? A sealed document. This is the bill. This is Baal. This is Baal right here. This is it. And this is the one Baal, the $1. That's why they have the one so prominently there, because this $1, not this one I have here, unfortunately, you understand it was not, because it was our crust to say this $1 is the cause of all the evil. But no, this basically $1 repeated often enough, what did it say, a lie repeated often enough becomes true. This lie, they have repeated it often enough until it is accepted, as being the truth, as being even greater, you understand, even greater than God, even greater than family, even greater than culture and society, even people who come from cultures that are thousands of years old, that are connected and related to the Bible, have sold their souls for this dollar. This dollar, I'm probably going to have to burn it or something like that. Have you ever burned a dollar? I never burned a dollar before, really. That would be interesting. But that's a way of really now freeing it and putting it into spiritual ether and letting go of it. It's a beautiful way of letting go. It's really a psychological way to really let go. But that being that, here it's saying in Pergamos or Pergamon, because the Europeans and the Germans have a big focus on this Pergamon. Speaking of Hitler and the Germans, you know, saying, let's see if we can put Pergamos right here. Let's put Pergamos. Let's put Pergamos, though they say Pergamon. Pergamon. Now, Pergamos and this thing called Satan's Seat is an actual seat that's actually in Germany. It's actually in Germany today. They took it from this ancient Pergamon. It was actually called Satan's Seat. And they took it to Germany, and Hitler had it used and used the design of it to give that address that you see in all those videos with all of those zombies, all of those drones, all of those blonde-haired, blue-eyed drones lined up in the stadium, and he's there waving around his hand and giving his speech, his anti-Christian speech. But it's interesting that everybody looked at Satan's point man, but no one really paid any attention to God's point man in that very same time. You know who God's point man was in that time? God's point man in that time was the conquering line of the tribe of Judah, Haile Selassie I, elect of God, King of Kings of Ethiopia. And the Ethiopians were those saints, those Kedusan, who were being persecuted in that very same time. But all the attention was to the converted Jews, the Khazars, but nobody gave any attention to the original black Jews and Christians or the Ethiopian Hebrews who were being persecuted by the Antichrist and the fascists in that very same time of the so-called 30s and 40s, right? That's very wrong. But it says, I know thy works and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is. And thou holdest fast my name and hast not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth. Now, we have to give the 700 Club. You understand? As they say, kudos, as it were, on the particular program that they did and aired recently on Satan's Seat. They did a program, and you probably can look it up on the internet. I think we saw it's on the YouTube as well, and it's at their program. Just look up Satan's Seat, or you know, ask one of the interactive operators or whatever, and they'll get it for you. You can find this out there. But it goes into the details, the historical. It gives a good historical contextualization to this. The shortcoming we feel and we know is that it did not go far enough. But then we say, hey, that's our job and role and responsibility to really take it to its fulfillment, the scriptural biblical fulfillment. You understand? But they did do a good program on Pergamos, on Satan's Seat. So yes, the 700 Club. Go check it out. Check it out on the internet if you want to find out more about it. And you will be as surprised as many that this is not something that was made up. So if that is true there, and that we see the connection with Hitler, and we see Hitler's connection with Mussolini, and Hitler was a blatant, unrepentant antichrist, and they both were fighting against and conspiring against God's people, and we see the persecution of Ethiopia. Ethiopia, in the 1930s, was the first victim of modern weapons of mass destruction. They used WMDs against defenseless Ethiopians in Ethiopia in the 1930s, and still there is a media blackout, a media silence to that. So therefore, when we see these things that are going on, we can't help but not really give a damn. Because if God's people are being persecuted and you turn away from the injustice done to God's people, and then injustice is done to you, well, why should I care? That might be actually, you know, your comeuppance. That might be you paying your spiritual bill or bail. But in verse 14 it says, "But I have a few things against thee. Because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam." But he says, I have what? He says, but I have a few things against thee. He's saying, all those other things, hey, you know, to this particular church in Pergamos, no problem with. But I have a few things against thee. And who is the one speaking? It is the Amen. It's our black Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the Amen, who is speaking. In other words, in your red-letter Bibles, if you look in your red-letter Bibles, it's Christ that's speaking in those so-called red letters. Of course, they put the red letters in, and some of y'all have a little problem with red letters. I've heard that discussion before, but let's deal with the real issues. All right? It says, but I have a few things against thee, because thou hast thee of them that hold the doctrine. They hold the doctrine of Balaam. Now, who is Balaam, and what is the doctrine? The doctrine means, in other words, a timheret, a teaching, a Talmud, if you please. But really, doctrine means, for English speakers, it means a teaching. Those who hold a teaching. There's a particular teaching of Balaam. So the Amen, our black Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach, he says, I have a few things against you. I like what you're doing here. You've been doing that well. But right here, I'm not pleased with that, because you have them there that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the Bani Yisroel. Who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel to eat things sacrificed to idols, and to commit fornication. Or let me update it for y'all so you will understand it. To commit pornication. To commit pornography. Pornication. We're not just talking about the triple X, XX, the hardcore sex stuff. You understand? This whole society has turned to fornication or pornication. But unfortunately, most people are so blind, you understand, that they can't really see it. You understand? They can't really see it. It's like that stupid judge who said, I know what pornography is, but I know it when I see it. You're stupid. But those are your judges, right? Verse 15 says, so hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitanes, which thing I hate. Just, I think it was yesterday for Rosh Hashanah, we did the teaching and we touched on the Nicolaitanes. So if you want to catch that particular program, check it out when we go into Revelation. I think it's in part 4 and part 5 of the Trumpet of Jah Rastafari that touches on the metaphysical rapture, that touches on the early church age and Revelation chapter 2. And then there's, a part 6, actually, that also speaks on Revelation chapter 2. And there we are, chapter 2, and which is actually the earlier, we're still in chapter 2, but the first two churches, the church of Ephesus and the church of Smyrna, which are dealt in, which we address, and we talk on the Nicolaitanes. The breakdown, the simple breakdown of Nicolaitanes, Niko, right? Niko means to conquer, and Laos mean the laity. The laity or the people. Generally, it's the people. But specifically, it means the unlettered people. The laity. Laity means that they are illiterate. They can't read. They can't read or they don't read. Or the priest class prevents the laity class from reading. You know, most of these bastard-ass churches, you have this priest and people division, and where in specific Catholicism and coming from that European strain of so-called Christianity, we have this like priests on one side, like the Catholic the Catholicos, and the people on the next side, and where they forbid, where it is verboten or forbidden to have the people able to read. This is what Martin Luther. Not Martin Luther King, but the other Martin Luther, you understand, this is what Martin Luther basically had protested against when he wrote up his, I think, what was it, 97 theses, but, you know, basically it was talking about the 97 theses or 99 theses of the Pope, all the shit that the Pope was doing against the Christian people. Martin Luther now had the ammunition because he was able to read the Bible, and he understood that once people were able to read for themselves, they could use their God-given heart and mind to decide for themselves. They didn't need no middleman. They didn't need no go-between. But see, that's the Nicolaitanes, just so you will understand in the overview, but the devil is really in the details. So if you want to know more about this and really see the apps, because there's many apps that are going on in the modern world, and unfortunately we don't have the opportunity to go through an exhaustive list. We give you the basics, you understand, and you have to work with that and build upon that. But it says in verse 16, repent, or else I will come to thee quickly. Repent. Or else I will come to thee quickly and will fight against them with the what? Sword of my mouth. So Christos, our black Lord and Savior, the Amen, is saying, repent, have a change of mind, have a metanoia. Have a metanoia, have a change of mind, a change of heart and mind. Or else I'm going to come against you quickly and will fight against them, but get this, with the sword of my mouth. With my metaphysical word, just like we are doing, with our metaphysical word, we are crushing Babylon, believe it or not. You understand? And for you unbelievers, we hope that you don't believe it. You understand? You know, we hope you don't believe it until it's too late, as it would be. But verse 17, because this is spiritual, if they can't get it, they can't get it. You understand? Work with what you can get. Work with what you can reach. It's beyond your reach. You understand? Verse 17 says, he that hath an ear, he that hath an ear, you not hear? He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit, the Ruach, the Menses, saith to the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth. In other words, no man will have this gnosis. You understand? This gnosis, this scientia, this science, saving he that kabbalahs it, saving he that kabbalah it, he that receiveth it. Now, let us understand two things that are going on in this one particular church here. We're at the third church. The third church. And we can say the third level of the church age from roughly about 316. 316, and then the next church is Thyatira, and this is about 500 A.D. So when we look at this historically and get the historical context, we see that the Amen, our Black Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMoshiach, was showing this to his disciples. These are the things, this is going to be how it's going to go. This is how it's going to go. You understand? Though everyone has a choice, a free choice, these are the dispensations. You understand? These are the ages. So now we're at this third stage of the Christian dispensation. And this third stage is now under imperial favor. Now we're getting, this is where the Roman Empire, Pergamos is where, you know why Pergamos, at some point now we understand why the Germans like everything Pergamos and everything that's dealing with Satan's seat from the time of Hitler even to now. Because Pergamos, right, Pergamos was when the Roman Empire would become the so-called Holy Roman Empire. This is when they're about to do this remix. You know what I'm saying? This historical political remix. Roughly right around this time. That is why when I talk about Satan's seat, this is why Hitler had to get Satan's seat. You know what I'm saying? He had to have that brought back to Germany. You know? And this is also now why when it talks about Balaam, that there were those who held two different doctrines. They held two different teachings. You remember when it talks about the horns of the beast? And the beast has these two kind of horns? They're holding these two different doctrines. One doctrine is the doctrine of Balaam. The second doctrine is the doctrine of the Nicolaitanes. Now, we touched on the doctrine of the Nicolaitanes, but now let us touch on the doctrine of Balaam. What is the doctrine of Balaam? See, we need to understand this. Then we can understand what are they making us do in paying their bills and using their sealed document, which in itself is a bill, you understand, or a sorcerer's agreement. You understand, this is a sorcerer's agreement. You understand, this is witchcraft. This is basically witchcraft. And let me, before some people get it twisted, those who overcome, who are overcomers, some garbage like this can't overcome you. Understand that. But those who are overcome by this, I hate to say it, but let's be blunt. They're fucked. You understand? You know, if you're overcome by that, yeah, I mean, in this world and the world to come, you know, or maybe you don't know. But anyway, the doctrine of Balaam, if we look at 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 15, there's a note there. The doctrine of Balaam, if we look at Jude, verse 11, there's a note there as well. So the Decumens Amoris, this is some of your journey, your journal or your study notes. Please put this down, 2 Peter 2 and 15, note, and Jude, verse 11, note. We're going to focus on the note that's right here in the Scofield Study Bible. The doctrine of Balaam was his teaching Balak to corrupt the people who could not be cursed. So the doctrine of Balaam was teaching Balak, a heathenish local ruler that saw the Beta Israel coming out and feared. It's like us going back to where we, our promised land in the east, and in Ethiopia and Africa, and some of those kiss-ass half-can Africans saying they're trying to stop us and block us. This is like what Balak was. So he's going out to his local shaman or his local witch doctor, and he's trying to cock up some little cuckoo voodoo and shit like that. And Balaam basically, he could not curse the Beta Israel. He said there's no divination against Israel. But he said, here's what we can do. And now this is the same technique and tactic that they used against the careless Ethiopians in Ethiopia 1974-75, where they could not do any divination against the King of Kings, against Haile Selassie, but they used Balaam's same technique. You know what I'm saying? What Balaam taught Balak was to corrupt the people. How did he corrupt the people? This is how. This is how, and to get them into this, this is how they corrupted the people. They corrupted the people through this, through means like this, should we say. Through means like that. You understand? Corrupt the people who could not be cursed. Now, we touched on this in the Torah portion. So those of our Hebrew Beta Rastafari Israel, brothers and sisters, the Hebrew brothers and sisters already know we've been there already, but it's a good place to return to and, you know, sit down and have a Bible study and the reasoning on this, because there is much embedded in it. You understand? There's much embedded in it. Never think like the jackass so-called Satanists, the Satanist drones out there who think like, oh, like there's nothing in the Bible or the Bible is a simplistic book. No, their mind is a simplistic place for their thoughts to dwell. That's why they can't get this. You understand? But Numbers 31, verse 15 and 16, Numbers 22 and 5, Numbers 23 and 8, by tempting them to marry women of Moab. What's that? Moab? That sounds like that. Who was Moab? Let us check this out right here. You remember the, I don't know if we can put this here, Moab. You remember Moab? We'll put this down here, over here. Moab. Mother of all bombs. Isn't that what they did when they went and got Nebuchadnezzar? When they got Nebuchadnezzar? Nebuchadnezzar. No, I'm talking about Saddam, Nebuchadnezzar. This is very trippy because prophecy shows that would come to pass. And I'm not too sure if Saddam was all familiar with that, but he fulfilled that. Anyway, the Americans have this bomb that they call the Moab bomb. It's the mother of all bombs. Even though Moab in the Hebrew means from the father, because the Moabites and the Ammonites, they were the children of the incestuous relationship that Lot's daughters had with their own father. You remember after the whole Sodom and Gomorrah nuking, you know, where the Lord had nuked Sodom and Gomorrah some three and a half thousand years ago, there was ancient nuclear wars. Yes, there was ancient nuclear wars. Do you think that this Peckerwood is the only one who developed nuclear technology, but they don't know how the pyramids was built? They now have to tell us that it's some aliens from another planet, because they just can't bow down to black man. They said, we won't be under blackmail. And that's what Satan said. Satan said in heaven, we won't be under blackmail. And that's what caused his fall, basically. Anyway, they tempted them to marry women of Moab, to marry foreign bitches. You understand? Heathenish bitches. I don't know any other way I can put it. Some people say, oh, that's cursing. No, well, cursing, the Lord says you're a curse if you go astray from his way. So that's a curse right there. Which curse is worse? You understand? Pointing out what the heathen are and who they are and giving them appropriate names, or going astray from this because you don't want to deal with the truth and being under the Almighty's curse. So think about it. Choose. Choose you this day who you will serve. They defiled their separation. They abandoned their pilgrim character. They had a certain character. It's just like what happened with this dollar bill. Let's get back to this dollar bill, or present it in its proper orientation. Let's get back to this dollar bill. What happened? They defiled their separation. Listen, let's go back to the beginning. The doctrine of Balaam was his teaching Balak to corrupt the people who could not be cursed, right? And he tempted them to marry woman of Moab. Now remember, woman of Moab. Moab was, the Moabites were a people who were the product of incest, where the daughters got their father drunk, right? And, well, I think y'all mature enough to know probably what happened after that, since they figured there was no other men in the world and everything, so they had seed from their father. So when they gave birth to the child, one of the daughters said, and I shall name him Moab, which in Hebrew mean like Imma'ab in the Gittites, or Moab in the Hebrew, from or out of the father, because that child was a product of their father's seed, you know, sperm. You get it? Anyway, they defiled their separation. The Israelites now defiled their separation. They were separate people. And see, that word separation is also kedisana. The word holy means to be separate, to be set apart, to be kedus, to be set apart. So they defiled their kedisana. So they defiled not only their separation, but their holiness. And they abandon their pilgrim character. They abandon their particular character as a people. It's like looking at some videos about Ethiopia, right? When you look at some videos of Ethiopia, and then you look at these careless Ethiopians, y'all ain't the same people. Y'all come from Mars or something like that. Where y'all come from? You understand? Y'all come from over there, for real? But how did that happen? Because of the spell. The spell of Leviathan. Don't you get it yet? Because of this spell. And this is the very same thing that the doctrine of Balaam is all about. Are you beginning to see the connection between paying bill or worshiping Baal and the Babylonian bell? In God we trust, will I am, the law of Thelema. You understand? Do what thou wilt shall be all of the law. Will and bill, will and bill. Remember, this is a W, right? You remember the Volkswagen, the VW conspiracy? What is the W called everywhere but over here in America? Americans so silly, they call it W. You understand? Everywhere else, they call it W. W. So this W, you understand, over is the same as the B. If you turn the B on the side, now look at this as well, too. Look at this particular dollar here. You see this particular dollar right here? It has a B on it, right? Let's get this close. It has a B on it. That B says New York. The B is for New York. Now, when we turn the B like this and we take away the top bar or the back bar, you understand? We take away that bar, we have a W with a bar. A W with a bar makes a B. Don't you see that? Here's the symbolic logic. Some people say, oh, you're just making up stuff. Well, you know what? That's exactly what they did right here. They made up stuff that you be lie even. You be lie even. But I know for you, it's okay. It is sick, sick, sick. You understand? It is okay to do that, right? Well, you're not an overcomer, but you have been overcome if you belie that. Now, it is this union or that union of the world with the church, which is spiritual unchastity or spiritual adultery. So from the church level, when the church now begins to make this union between itself and the world, this is spiritual adultery. This is fornication. This is where the church now becomes proverbially that bitch ass hoe from God's perspective. And God, this is, if you could read the Hebrew, if you could read it in its context, not like these Gentiles, its proper context, God is calling Babylon a bitch, a hoe, you know, a motherfucking slut. Excuse me, I should have warned you if you have your children listening, but they need to understand, hear these words. They need to hear these words in its proper context. You know what I mean? In its proper context. It's like people say, you should never, never, ever hit nobody or use violence. No, you should know when and where to use it and use it properly. You know what I mean? Everything has its balance to it. But it's, the Bible says they've lost the balance in their minds. Because of balance in their mind, they have lost. Now, Pergamos had lost the pilgrim character and was dwelling. It was dwelling where Satan's throne is. Where are we dwelling? You understand? B. The B for New York, New York. The B. You understand? Where Satan's throne is in the world. Throne is in the world. Now, with this being a little better established, you understand? You remember what Christ did when Christ looked at the coin? And he said, whose inscription is on this coin? And they said, Caesar. And Christ said, give unto Caesar what is Caesar, but give unto God what is God's. Now, a lot of folks would say that. Well, like Christ said, give unto Caesar what is Caesar, give unto God what is God. Right? And they're going to say that so they can keep worshiping their false gods, worshiping the system lords, the Baal, Balaam. They're not doing it. They're not doing what God says. You understand? You know what it means for us, what Christ meant for us, and it's a good thing Christ said that, our Lord and Savior. Yes, in this system, we have to use this. Keyword, use this. Occasionally, we should actually burn this too. Occasionally, just to break our to break that spell. You see, some people can't even burn a $1 bill, a $1. They're not losing because they figure they're gonna lose so much. I would feel sorry for their souls, but it's not my soul. They gotta take responsibility for themselves, especially if they're fully grown. But unfortunately, a lot of the so-called fully grown people are full grown. You understand? They are full grown, not fully grown. So, understanding this in God we trust right here, connected with the paying bill. Paying bill is worshiping bill. You understand? The Babylonian bell. Because how in the world do we have to pay for water which God causes for free? Think about it for a moment. We're not saying that there should not be anything like exchange or barter. In fact, barter. There's a good article in who is it? Adolf Erman's book on ancient Egypt, where he's talking about bartering, how bartering was done in ancient times. And a lot of people think that no civilized, no, as white man, the Gentiles have this psychobabble. And you can read it in some of their economic books and speculative theories and so forth and so on, where they say no civilized society can come about off of the bartering system. You need to have this gold to money and so forth and so on. And then they discovered more and more in ancient Egypt, right? And discovering ancient Egypt and other ancient civilization, even Africa, some parts of Africa, and this is probably years ago, these parts of Africa probably now are, westernized, just like almost everywhere else. I mean, not just on the outside. The outside westernization, putting on a western-style clothing and keeping your inside pure is one thing. But they're westernized on the inside and outside. That's what we call these so-called Africans, half a can. Anyway, they noticed that in ancient times, as well as certain places today, probably very few nowadays, people do barter, and the way that they barter is very interesting, how the sense of value. You see, all of this comes down to this word right here. You understand? Value. You understand? You can almost call it a valve. You notice something? How I wrote this? Value is V-A-L-U-E. How do you spell valve? If you change the V and the U, what do you got? So value is a valve. It's a particular valve, a value system. What they have corrupted is our sense of value. You understand? And this is why we are allowing, as humanity, the earth, the water, to be polluted. We're allowing these peckerwoods and others to take the land and claim that they own the river, that they own the park, that they own the sky, so forth and so on. When did they ever pay God anything? They don't even pay God attention. You understand? The true God. They don't pay the true God any attention. So please understand there's a connection between paying bills in the Babylon Bell, and like some of them say, this is only the beginning. So stay tuned. Shalom. Ras Tefera.